Hi friends, and thank you for joining us in this nightly read-along. Don't forget to ask your parent to subscribe so you don't miss any future chapters. Now here's Miss Kate with tonight's chapters.
Since chapter 31, Siobhan, Washington, August 10th, 1957. Siobhan readjusted the red scarf around her neck as she and Coach Robert Hicks parked outside the Wallace High School tennis courts. She was glad she'd worn a blouse and poodle skirt. It was almost 80 degrees outside, much too hot for the jeans she'd originally planned to wear. Plus, she liked how she looked in her current outfit. Everything from the high heels to the deep red lipstick that matched her scarf. She'd wanted to look nice for herself and for Reggie. She didn't know when she'd be seeing him again. A full moon hung high in the sky, illuminating the parking lot. Ahead of them, 10 vehicles sat just outside the chain-link fence surrounding the court, including Coach Douglas's Buick and Chip's truck, all of them with their engines running and their headlights on. They must have been using them to provide additional light for the game. Siobhan paused as the door to Chip's truck opened. He stepped out of the cab, then began walking toward them. "Hello, Coach," Chip said, shaking Robert Hicks' hand. Then he nodded toward her. "Hey, Siobhan, glad to see you made it." "There was no way I was missing tonight," she said. She turned as another car entered the parking lot. Her body tensed as the vehicle rolled past them and parked alongside the fence. "That's just Reverend Hollister," Robert Hicks said, placing his bare of a hand on Siobhan's shoulder. "Let me catch up with him. I'll see you in the stands in a bit." His gaze bounced from her to Chip. "Don't stand out here talking for too long, Siobhan. I'll be sitting with Smitty." They both nodded as Coach Hicks walked over to greet the thin white man exiting the car. Her father and Coach Turner could only agree on one person to serve as an umpire, Reverend Stephen Hollister. He was a pastor of a small Methodist church just outside the city, and he was known to be sympathetic to Negro causes. Given the secrecy of the exhibition, he was as close to impartial as the Perkins team was going to get. But with only one umpire, it would have taken all night for each of the boys to play, so the coaches decided to modify the scoring. The exhibition would consist of three sets, Wallace's top three players against Perkins' best three. Each pair would play a shortened set, where the first boy to win four games with a two-game advantage would win the set. The team with the best two out of three sets would be the victor. "Is the team ready?" she asked. Chip picked at some grit underneath his fingernail. "As ready as they're going to be." He paused for a moment, staring at the ground, then added, Your boyfriend plays in the second set. Coach Dubb wanted to put his best two players first. So Chip knew about Reggie, too. But she was glad. She was tired of all the secrets, all the silence. "Who's Reggie playing against?" "Glenn Allen," Chip said, "but Reggie can beat him, I think, as long as he stays focused." Chip finally smiled. "How is it that I go off to college and you fall head over heels in love with another fella?" "It was a surprise to me, too." She touched her bracelet. The metal felt cool, even in this hot weather. "But I really do love him. He's kind and smart and so good, most of the time." She smiled at the thought of Reggie. It felt strange to be saying all this out loud, but it was also empowering. She'd wanted to talk about Reggie to someone, anyone, ever since they'd started seeing each other. "I guess you know my daddy doesn't really approve of him." Chip nodded. She tried to read his expression, but it was a clean slate. "Maybe in college if you and he..." "Reggie's not going to college. His grandma barely has enough money to keep the lights on, much less send him off to school." "Well, what about scholarships?" "They don't grow on trees. Plus, his grades weren't good enough. He was always working too much to finish his assignments." She took a step forward. "For a second, I thought about running away with him." "What?" Anger flashed across Chip's face. "Please don't tell me you're running off with that boy." "Don't yell," she said, "and Reggie isn't a boy. He's only a year younger than you." Chip seemed to consider this. "You're right," he said quietly. "I'm sorry, I didn't mean it like that." She nodded at him, letting him know it was okay. "And of course, I'm not going to leave with Reggie. Not because I don't want to. It's just, if I ran away, I'd never be able to come back home. I'd never see Mama and Daddy or any of my friends." "Your daddy would eventually forgive you." "Are we talking about the same Big Dub?" She looked toward the court. The cars were blocking her view, but she could hear the sound of tennis balls bouncing against the ground. "We should head on in." Chip rubbed the back of his head. "Want to sit with us?" "Better not," she said. "Don't want to cause a scene." "Yeah, you're probably right. Mary and Alan is already riled up. It would just make things worse if he saw you with us." He shook his head. "People aren't even forcing us to sit apart, and we're still segregating ourselves." "I wasn't talking about that," she said. "I don't want Reggie to see us together. He doesn't really like you." As Chip smirked, Siobhan rolled her eyes. "Don't let that get to your head, Charles." She started toward the gate. "Wait here for a few minutes, then you can follow me in." Siobhan caught sight of Reggie as she entered the fence. He and the other boys stood with her farther in the stood with her father in the court nearest the stand, softly lobbing tennis balls to one another. They all wore white shorts and white collared shirts. Her mama had spent the last few nights sewing the school logo onto the pockets. She walked up the bleachers and took a seat beside Coach Hicks. He sat about halfway up, with Mr. Smith and a few other Negroes. Siobhan quickly counted the number of white people in the stands. There were at least 20, and many of them seemed to be friends with Marion Allen. She wondered how many people Marion had told about this secret game. Siobhan glanced back toward the court. Reggie had finally caught sight of her. He smiled, giving her a wave with his racket. Of course, her father noticed this as well. He tapped Reggie on the head, breaking the boy's eye contact with Siobhan. Then he ordered the boys to sit back down. The first set was about to begin. Jackie Harris took his place on one side of the court, and a large Wallace player lined up on the opposite baseline. Coach Hicks told her his name, Harold Buckner. Siobhan didn't know him. The only player on the Wallace team she recognized was Glenn Allen. Harold lofted the ball high into the air, then delivered his serve. Siobhan felt herself leaning forward as Jackie returned the ball. Tennis matches were always quiet. There was never any of the hooping and hollering you got at football or basketball games. But the silence at the beginning of this game was unlike anything Siobhan had ever experienced. It was like everyone was holding their breaths, waiting for the first point, waiting while the ball bounced between Jackie and Harold, between black and white. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 times. Eventually, Harold scored the first point against Jackie. Everyone let out a breath, and Marion Allen stood up and cheered. The game continued, with Marion letting out a little whoop every time Harold scored, and her father nodding in approval when Jackie returned the favor. Harold was good enough to easily win the first two games, but Siobhan noticed how hard he was breathing. He was out of shape, and was clearly tired by the middle of the third game. Her father must have noticed as well, because after a timeout, Jackie moved to the baseline and played a more defensive strategy. Instead of trying to hit winning shots like before, Jackie focused on just keeping the ball in play, forcing Harold to expend more energy chasing the ball around the court, which led to Harold becoming even more tired and making more errors. Harold was barely even trying to move by the last game. So set one went to Jackie, 5-3. The boys met at the net. Jackie held out his hand, and after an eternity, Harold gave it a half-hearted shake. Siobhan rubbed her bracelet for good luck as Reggie warmed up with his teammate, Mordecai. A few feet away, Glenn Allen knocked around balls with another Wallace player. Glenn was wound up pretty tightly, Siobhan thought. He was pounding the ball when he only needed to gently return it. His Wallace teammate had to duck once to avoid the tennis ball smashing against his jaw. Reggie looked loose, but his face was stern. He kept stealing glances at everyone, Glenn, Allen, Siobhan, and even Chip. Siobhan saw Chip flash Reggie a thumbs up the next time he glanced in the stands, but Reggie just snorted and went back to trading serves. She shook her head. Chip really didn't have a clue. "Keep your eyes open," Coach Hicks said to Mr. Smith as the boys returned to their seats. "It's about to get real interesting with Glenn Allen taking the court." After a quick discussion with the coaches, Reverend Hollister motioned for Reggie and Glenn to greet each other before the game started. Neither one moved. Likewise, neither coach made any attempt to tell his players to shake hands. Finally, the Reverend shook his head and pointed them to their positions. He threw the ball to Reggie for the first serve. Reggie bounced the ball a few times, called out the score, and fired the ball at Glenn so hard that the boy couldn't return it. 15-0, 30-0, 40-0, game. Reggie looked at the stands, toward Marion Allen, and smirked. After switching sides, Glenn served for the next game and started off just as strongly as Reggie with two aces, but Reggie figured out how to return his serve on the next point, eventually bringing the score to 30-all. Then, when Reggie earned the lead on the next score, a devastating cross-court shot, he smirked again, this time at Chip. "He's way too cocky for his own good," Siobhan whispered. "Yeah, but look where he learned it from," Coach Hicks said, nodding toward her father. He had a grin on his face even larger than Reggie's. Dub jumped up and fist-pumped after Reggie won the final point, giving him the second game. The boys switched sides again, but instead of crossing on opposite ends of the net like before, they crossed on the same side. Reggie whispered something as he passed Glenn. Glenn responded by ramming him with his elbow. Siobhan tensed up, ready to move. Reggie just laughed. Siobhan closed her eyes and offered up a prayer. She wanted Reggie to hurry and win these last two games, and then it would be over. The Perkins team would have proved they could beat the best tennis team in the state, and everyone would go home safely. When she opened her eyes, she saw her father talking with Reggie. Reggie pulled back with a look of shock on his face. Then he smiled and nodded. On Reggie's first serve, he mistakenly double-faulted, giving Glenn a 15-0 lead for the game. Siobhan didn't understand. Reggie was the best server on the team. He never faulted, much less double-faulted. On the next point, Reggie was slow to respond to a drop shot that barely crossed the net, giving Glenn another score. This went on a few more times, and suddenly, Glenn Allen had won his first game. Siobhan looked at her father, assuming that steam was about to shoot from the man's head, but Big Dub just sat there, slowly nodding, his hand on his chin. Siobhan realized what was going on. They were toying with Glenn, stretching the match out. They wanted to humiliate him. Glenn began game four with a weak serve. Reggie responded with an even weaker return that bounced into the net. But after letting Glenn run up the score 40-0 in Glenn's favor, Reggie came storming back, showing off the ferocious returns he'd put aside for the past two games. He surged ahead, easily winning every remaining point. Siobhan took a deep breath. Reggie needed one more game. She watched as Reggie glanced at her father. Big Dub pressed his hands together, then slowly pulled them apart. And Reggie lost the next game through a mix of unforced errors and weak backhands. Siobhan was sure everyone could see the farce this exhibition had become. That is, everyone except Marion Allen. He kept cheering, getting louder and louder as his brother pulled ahead, only to fall silent and sulk whenever Glenn began to lose. Finally, as Glenn prepared to serve for the sixth game, Siobhan saw her father run his hand across his neck in a slicing motion. Reggie grinned. Then his eyes narrowed, and he turned his attention to his opponent. Glenn served the ball. Reggie knocked it back so fast that Glenn could only watch as the ball bounced past him. As it became clear that Reggie planned to win this game, Coach Turner tried to argue a couple of the umpire's calls, but even he eventually stopped once the score became out of reach. Glenn glanced nervously at his brother. Then, right before what was sure to be his final serve, Glenn made a grand gesture of pulling a tennis ball from his pocket and placing it on the ground. He went to kick it out of the way, but instead, he somehow stepped on it, yelping. He dropped his racket and fell to the ground. "My ankle, I think I sprained it." Siobhan rolled her eyes. Sure, it wasn't nice the way Reggie had toyed with him, but this was just delaying the inevitable. Was it so insulting for Glenn to lose to a colored player that he would rather fake an injury? Coach Turner knelt in front of Glenn as Marion rushed over. They helped Glenn to his feet and led him to the bleachers. She was sure Glenn favored the wrong foot. "We need to reschedule the exhibition," Marion yelled. "He can't play on a bum ankle." "Yeah," another white man yelled. "Don't let the game end like this. This ain't fair." Siobhan watched her father and Adam Douglas saunter over to Reverend Hollister and Coach Turner in the center of the court. "Come on," Robert Hicks said, standing. "It's time for us to leave." Siobhan frowned. "But I promised Big Dub I'd get you out of here the minute things went bad," Coach Hicks said. "And that's exactly what's about to happen." "I'll follow you down," Mr. Smith said. "See if I can talk some sense into Dub." "Look, I didn't make up the rules here," Reverend Hollister was saying to Coach Turner once Siobhan, Coach Hicks, and Mr. Smith reached the bottom of the bleachers. "No substitutions." Coach Hicks kept walking past the court toward the exit, but Siobhan paused. Then she slowly inched along the bottom row, trailing behind Mr. Smith. She wanted to get closer so she could hear better. "Siobhan," Coach Hicks hissed, "what are you doing?" Ignoring him, she took a seat. Reggie stood a few feet away, but he was too caught up in the conversation to notice her. "Either your player forfeits the set or he gets back out there and finishes the game," Reverend Hollister continued. "That's final." "No, we need to reschedule," Coach Turner said. "And what? We forget the current score and start all over again?" Big Dub shook his head. "Come on, Coach, you're a man of integrity." "You're a fine one to be talking about integrity with the stunt you just pulled," Coach Turner crossed his arms. "And I don't care what the rules are. I'm not about to let word get out that we lost to a bunch of colored boys." "Who exactly are you worried about?" Dub asked, his grin widening. "Marion Allen? Fine, I'll tell him." Adam Douglas grabbed Dub's arm. "Reverend Hollister is the one in charge here. Let's have him make the announcement." He turned to the Reverend. "Don't tell them we won. Say they lost because of forfeit due to injury." "But that's a lie," Big Dub said. "A win's a win," Adam said. Siobhan looked up as Robert Hicks wrapped his hand around her arm. "You've heard enough." He pulled her to her feet. "Or do you want me to talk to your daddy about this?" Shaking her head, she glanced back at her father. He was talking with the team, the grin on his face wide and bright. She wanted to call out to Reggie to tell him goodbye, but decided against it. As Siobhan followed Coach Hicks from the court, she heard Reverend Hollister addressing the small crowd. A few people booed and others cursed. Some yelled, "Them colored boys cheated, didn't they?" Then she heard glass smashing against the ground. She whipped back around. Adam Douglas and Chip had corralled the Perkins team and was leading them away from the bleachers. A glass bottle had shattered a few feet away from them, but none of the boys seemed to be injured. Her father remained on the court, but Mr. Smith was doing his best to pull him away as well. "Let's go," Robert Hicks said, grabbing her arm again. This time he didn't release her until he'd placed her in the car. As she rubbed her arm, she searched the crowd, looking for Reggie. All she saw was a sea of white faces, and they were all angry. Chapter 32. On Saturday morning, after a quick game of basketball, Candace and Brandon biked to the library to search as many books as they could about sports. It turned out there were a whole bunch of teams called the Oilers, so Brandon picked books about the Negro Leagues, hockey, and football. They made a list of all the famous players from each of the teams, then added pi to each famous player's jersey number, but didn't know what to look for after that. In addition to Brandon's books, Candace chose a book about tennis and a biography of Althea Gibson, the African-American woman who won Wimbledon in 1957. Ellie had mentioned how Coach Washington had wanted Siobhan to be the next Althea Gibson. Maybe there is more to the connection. They returned home to see their mothers on Brandon's porch drinking coffee. They dropped their bikes in the yard and walked up the steps. "About time," Brandon's mother said. "We've got to get a move on. Don't want to miss the African dance performance. It's the best part of the festival." "Sorry we're late," Brandon said. "Research." "I can't wait to see your project," his mother continued as she kissed him on the cheek. "Y'all sure are spending enough time on it." Brandon shrugged. "Yeah, Candace has been a big help." "And what about you, Mom? How was your morning?" Candace asked, trying to change the subject. "Pretty good," she said between sips of coffee. "I revised one chapter and added a new scene. Slow and steady wins the race. But enough about me. Tell me about this project." "Not yet," Candace said. "You know, slow and steady wins the race. We'll tell you all about it once we're finished." Then she smiled. "So, do we need to grab lunch before we head to the park?" "There'll be plenty of food there from local restaurants," her mom said. "I hope Sam's has a booth," Tori said as she stepped onto the porch from the house. The Westin game was tucked underneath her arm. "I'm craving a chili cheese dog." "That sounds nice," Candace's mother said. She smiled as she noticed the book. "Hey, I know that book," she said, reaching for it. "My mother loved it." Candace could feel her eyes bugging out of her head. "She did?" Her mother nodded as she flipped it open. "Yeah, we have a copy at home somewhere. She even tried to get you to read it when you were younger, but you didn't seem interested and she didn't want to force it." Candace turned to Brandon. His mouth was hanging open. "So, about those chili cheese dogs," her mother continued, handing the book back to Tori. "Do you know if they have a low-fat option or maybe a vegetarian?" She trailed off as a large SUV pulled up in front of the Joneses' house. The windows were too tinted for them to see who was inside. "Trouble," Tori mumbled. "Hush," her mother said. She waved as Millie Stanford stepped out of the vehicle. Milo was dressed in a black basketball jersey. "We saw you all and figured we'd stop to say hello," Mrs. Stanford said. "Okay, you've said it," Tori whispered. "Now you can leave." Miss Jones smiled at Millie as she pinched her daughter's arm. "Enough," she whispered through her teeth. "I was hoping to see you at the game," Mrs. Stanford said to Candace as she reached the bottom step. "Milo scored 15 points and 7 rebounds," Milo added. "Almost a double-double." Candace shrugged. "Oh, sorry, I guess I got the dates wrong." "It's so nice to finally meet you," Mrs. Stanford said to Candace's mother. "I'm Millie, and this is Milo. I met your daughter at church last week." She batted her eyelashes. "Maybe we'll see you there this Sunday." "Perhaps," her mother replied, shaking the woman's hand. Mrs. Stanford looked at their house across the street. "I was so sorry to hear about your mother's death. If you don't mind me asking, how did she pass away?" "Heart disease," her mother said. "Ah, yes, it's one of those silent killers." She readjusted her sunglasses. "I thought that, and please don't take this the wrong way. Perhaps she had been suffering from dementia," she said, "you know, given everything that happened before with the park and the tennis courts and..." "Trust me," her mother crossed her arms and stood taller. "It was a heart attack." Mrs. Stanford clearly wasn't getting the hint. "There are a lot of factors that could lead to someone passing away. My best friend's father has Alzheimer's. It's such a dreadful disease, and it causes him to act so strangely." She smiled wide enough to eclipse the sun. "I'm sorry for prying. Just the more we know about our loved one's health, the more we know about our health." "Yes, well, thank you so much for your concern." Candace's mother looked at her watch. "We were about to head to the Juneteenth festival. Perhaps we'll see you there." "I heard it was boring," Milo said, frowning. "Nothing but a bunch of stories about how we used to be slaves." Mrs. Stanford quickly patted Milo's shoulder. "Oh, you know, these boys, they don't appreciate cultural education. We've hoped to attend every year, but we always had a conflict." She leaned closer. "Although, of all the places to hold it, why would they choose Vickers Park? It's just not safe." "I hadn't heard about any crime at the park," Brandon's mother said. "Has something happened there recently?" "Perhaps not the park itself," Mrs. Stanford clarified, "but you know that neighborhood." "Isn't Vista Heights the oldest African-American neighborhood in Lambert?" Candace's mom asked. "It seems like the perfect place to hold a celebration of our freedom." "Oh, yes, perhaps, if you put it like that," Mrs. Stanford looked at her own watch. "I should let you go. Feel free to call if you need anything. Juanita has my number." She smiled at Candace. "Same for you. Maybe we should have you over for a play date? I'm sure you're into just as many of those dreadful shoot-them-up video games as the rest of these kids." She and Milo walked back to their SUV. "I will never speak to you again if you go to Milo's house for a play date," Brandon deadpanned to Candace. "But what about all those dreadful video games?" she asked. "And how else is his mom supposed to spy on us if I don't talk to her?" "Don't be so snarky," Candace's mother said. "We hardly know them. I'm sure Milo is quite nice." "He's not," Candace said. "Nope," Brandon agreed. "They're right," Tori said, still rubbing her arm where her mother had pinched her. We've known Milo since we moved here. He's as rotten as they come. I'm guessing pretty much everyone in the neighborhood knows that. Everyone except his mother, Ms. Jones said. But what can I say? People see what they want to see, especially about people they love. She leaned over and pecked Tori on the cheek. It's the fallacy of mothers, she sighed, and wives. Candace turned to watch Mrs. Stanford drive off. It seemed rude to be looking at Brandon's mom right then when she felt sure Ms. Jones was really talking about someone else. But at least you two don't have to worry about Millie for much longer, Ms. Jones continued, filling the silence. Candace turned back around. Why do you say that? Ms. Jones' mouth gaped. She looked at Candace's mother. I ruined the surprise, didn't I? It wasn't a surprise, Candace's mother said, her words measured. I just wasn't sure until last night. She glanced at Brandon. Maybe we can talk about it later? You sold the house, didn't you? Candace asked. She crossed her arms. No, it's not that, her mother said. Then she sighed. Might as well tell it. The house is still on the market, but your father's friend completed all the major renovations and brought in a new crew for the finishing touches. The realtor thinks she can sell the house even if we're living in it. She took a deep breath. We can head back to Atlanta as early as next weekend. Candace blinked. That soon? I know the idea of moving has been really hard on you, her mother continued. I know how much you miss your father and how much he misses you. Now you'll have a chance to hang out with Dee Dee and Courtney a little before school starts. Isn't that great? Candace nodded. Yeah. She looked at Brandon, but she couldn't see his face. He was staring at the ground, his hands tight around his backpack straps. Would he keep searching for Parker's fortune without her if they didn't find it before she left? Would he still share it with her? And once she did leave, who would play basketball with him in the backyard? Who would he trade books with? Who would she trade books with? Tori wrapped her arm around her brother's neck. Hey, I left something upstairs. Walk with me, okay? He nodded quickly, still looking down, and let his sister lead him inside. Candace wanted to follow them so badly. She wanted to say something to Brandon, anything, but she didn't know what. And then he was gone.